Welcome to Off the Cut, a podcast where we talk about building, making,
and answering all of your questions.
I'm Eric from Spensley Design Co.
And I'm Zach from Zach Builds. If you have a question that you would like us to answer on air, you can send it to offthecutpodcast@gmail.com.
You can find both of us on YouTube, Instagram, and unfortunately, because we have to keep up with kids, you can find us on TikTok too.
All right, now let's get into the show.
Give yourself a round of applause because you've just entered Off the Cut episode 93. Ooh, that's a nice golf clap. Nice. We're up in Toronto and here in Ohio. Today is known as Tuesday, December 5th, 2023, which means the Green Suitors podcast. The worst would work. Oh, God.
Oh, you were going fast, too.
I know.
Playing through that intro.
The worst woodworking podcast in our space, available on Apple and Spotify, still sucks. But you know what doesn't suck?
I do. KM Tools, baby.
Yeah, the fine selection of tools that KM Tool has, which is run by our good friend Jonathan Katz-Moses.
Heck and, yeah.
You know, what's his deal, Zach? What's his deal?
I'll tell you what the slogan of his of KM Tools is. It's all by woodworkers for woodworkers.
Yeah. And what does that mean?
And that means that anything on kmtools.com is either produced and made by Jonathan and his team, or it's stuff they have in their shop. So it's products that he personally likes.
Yeah. And it's all good stuff. No hot garbage, like all the nonsense you see, especially this time of year on Facebook.
Oh, my Lord. Yeah. No, it's all high quality stuff. No volume stuff. Nothing that no cheap China stuff that he gets a good deal on that he can mark up like crazy. It's all high quality products.
Yeah. Plus, a portion of all their profits go directly to the Katz-Moses Woodworkers with Disabilities Fund, which helps get tools and resources in the hands of those who need it most. And every single month, we're giving away a $50 gift card to KM Tools. All that you have to do to sign up for that is join us on Patreon, and you're automatically entered to win. Mm-hmm. Nothing else. Mm-hmm. So huge thanks to Jonathan and KM Tools for sponsoring the show.
Yes, definitely a huge thank you to him for that. I talked to our winner from last week, Chris,
yeah,
who got himself a Rotor Plane.
Yep.
A Rotor Plane Pro, I should say.
Yes, the new one.
The new one. He also got a $50 gift card, and earlier today I sent him out a bunch of Off the Cut stickers, some Zach Build stickers, and so he's hooked up. And my favorite part about this whole story is he's the lowest tier of Patreon supporter, so I think he pays $3 a month.
Right.
So he just 100x'd his investment on this podcast.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, Derek, dial your volume down like one.
Oh, too hot.
You're coming a little hot. Was he a little hot for you, Zach?
A little bit. Okay. But I like it better. Sometimes Derek's a little quiet, so I figured maybe it's better to have him. He's like, it's equalizing for all those other episodes where he was a little quiet.
You know what? You know, in Seinfeld, they have the one character that's the close talker.
Yeah.
Derek's the quiet talker.
The quiet talker, yeah.
Wait, isn't there a Seinfeld episode about that too? Like a whisperer, right?
Yeah, is it George is dating a woman who's a really quiet talker?
I think so.
Yeah. Have you ever met a quiet talker in real life?
Oh, yeah. There's a girl that I work with. Well, I don't actually work with her. She's in the same company. Has been on a couple like phone calls. And like when she talks, I have to jack up my volume to like 75 and I still can't hear her.
Is she like that in real life too? Have you ever met this woman in real life?
No.
Okay.
So I'm maybe fortunate it's just technical to not have met the vast majority of people I work with.
Yeah. So actually, can we roll back? Well, you might not want to talk about this.
I don't care.
So did you start your job as a remote job or did you used to go into the office?
No, I used to go in the office for like 2 or 3 years.
Okay. So you don't know any of these people, even though you went to the same office for them for 2 or 3 years?
So the predominant folks that I interact with on a day-to-day basis are like the sales folks.
Mm-hmm.
So they're remote and they travel like crazy. So I've never met most of them.
Okay, that makes sense.
I've met my boss and then my other counterpart. the vast majority of the other people that I talk to, I've never met.
So you just work in this little social island where you don't have to deal with most of the business.
Great. And I've never turned my camera on at home either.
Oh, that's nice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I need to get a job where I don't have to talk to anybody else, where I can just be alone at home.
No. Zach, you're trying to get out away from the remodeling and contracting and stuff.
I know.
You don't need to be adding a job.
Well, my YouTube job is perfect for me because I do just do exactly what I say. You know, like I go to the shop, I work on my little nerdy video game projects. I come home, I record little segments and I edit. It's great. I don't ever have to see anybody or do anything. I don't want to. It's perfect for shut-in like me.
But it's a pro and a con. Because like,
yeah,
I tell Miranda this some days, like, you know, I'll say goodbye to her in the morning or whatever. I could literally go until 6 o'clock at night when she comes home. And I have not opened my mouth and spoken a word. Oh, and it's weird.
Yes, I do that all the time. And then when finally she comes home,
it's like, ugh.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Are you like a little weird when she comes home? You're like, oh, sorry, I'm out of practice. I don't know what I'm doing with my mouth.
Well, hey-o. No, but see, it's weird because we always talk about it. She's like, she'll come home and she's been talking to people all day. So she's like,
yeah.
I just need to breathe her. And I'm like a puppy. I'm like, people, like, I'm so excited. Right.
Well, I was saying this to Scott Walsh, I think on the week you were away, I find the days when I talk to the camera, like if I'm in the shop and I have to film a lot of stuff talking to the camera, I find that kind of draining of my emotional energy. Like to me, that's almost the same level of exertion as talking to a group of people, because I guess in my head I'm like kind of pretending it is.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I find on those days when I come home, I'm like, I just want to be alone for a little bit. But the days when I'm just home editing, when Sophie gets back from work, I'm like, yeah, let's talk, let's chat.
Yeah.
I'm lonely.
It really it is draining to, especially it's like a talking head video, like the one I put out that's still going bananas. I don't know how, but I'll take it. Nice rebound. When I was like talking to the camera, it's exhausting. Yeah. Because if I just sit there and I'm like, so the next tool is this, like you have to be.
Bring that energy.
I mean, I hate to say it, but you're putting on a performance.
Yeah, of course you are. I mean, at the very least, you're presenting. Like, you have to, like, put a little energy behind it.
Right.
If everybody think back to the last time they saw somebody speak in public and the person was super low energy.
Right.
You just want to get out of there as soon as possible. So, even if you're not, you know, acting, you're still kind of putting your, I don't know, there's like, you put on, like, your presenter voice or whatever.
I like the term presenting. Yeah. I think that sounds better.
Yeah.
Ugh. Like a baboon.
Like a baboon. That's right.
There are a lot of actors out there. You know what a synonym for actors is?
No.
Presenter?
Green Suitors podcast fan.
Oh. Got him. Nice.
Well, we got some things to talk about. First thing, some admin stuff.
Oh. On air admin stuff.
So, yeah. Derek did some research for us. And if you guys recall a couple episodes ago, we brought up the idea of getting Gary Busey's son on the show.
Jake Busey.
So, Derek, you looked it up. And I know you're pulling it up right now. What are his rates? So, if we want to get Jake Busey on the show, Gary Busey's son, what are we talking?
Well, you said to start, so there's a publicly advertised rate. We're talking about cameo.com for everybody who's like a couple episodes behind. We're talking about cameo.com. You can pay C and D and F-list celebrities anywhere from, I don't know, $10 to $1,000 to give you personalized messages. Yeah. So we thought it would be funny if we got Jake Busey to, you know, read the intro or do something related to the podcast. But then Derek looked into it more. So there's two tiers of rates. There's like the normal one. If you want to just get him for your friend's birthday, it's whatever it is, like $69
right now.
Nice. But if you want it for if you want it for a commercial product, which technically this podcast would be, then
$4,999 for a 15-day license.
Ooh. So apparently Jake Busey doesn't get out of bed for anything less than 5 G's.
Now, so would that
we
mean
can
that we
get
would
somebody
have...
for under 100?
Oh, okay. Who can we get for under 100?
All right, so I got to sort them. I don't know off the top of my head, but
all right, sorting it back to us.
It's going to be funny because you're going to have to list 10 names before we strike on one that any of us knows.
I think some of these people might be dead.
They're just impersonators.
Paul
probably.
Abdul.
Larry.
The cable guy?
Larry Hankin, the upstairs neighbors from Friends, Mr. Heckles.
Oh, really?
I think he passed away, though.
I mean...
Because he's listed as free.
That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I don't know. Cameo seems like a scam.
I think if the account goes unattended for a certain amount of time, it just defaults to like a lower tier.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Get Cranky Santa.
Cranky Santa.
45.
Everybody knows Cranky Santa.
I've known. Oh, I was like, I don't know who this is.
That was my sarcasm. That was sarcasm. Sorry.
But anyway, even if we did get $5,000 for Jake Busey's, intro to the podcast, it works for 15 days. So would we have to take the episode down after 15 days?
Yeah,
we'll edit that part out, I assume.
Yeah, something like that. Huh? Do you think we could get enough listens in 2 days or 2 weeks to make $5,000?
No, we would. I tell you what. I will make this a personal pledge. If we can get 1,000 patrons, we will get Jake Busey on the podcast.
Okay. Okay. What about, okay, hear me out here. What about if I paid Jake Busey to do a birthday shout out for my friend Eric, and then we played that on air? Is that?
Ooh.
Are we loopholing him there?
Working in some gray area.
Yeah, I think we're going to need to get a lawyer involved in this.
Yeah. Well, get back to me on that one.
Okay.
You got to know.
Jared, just real quick, I got to know. Are there any recognizable names for under $100?
Man, I really don't see anybody I recognize.
Okay, that's not shocking.
Is Jason Ben on there? Ronnie Fulton?
Shockingly, no. No.
Arthur Ryan. Can we see if there's any woodworking YouTubers on Cameo so we can roast them a little bit?
Oh, I think Jason is. Bird Moth.
Let's go back to... That seems like actually on brand for him.
Right.
Because he would probably actually make a fair bit of money doing that.
I looked at his just out of curiosity, and one of his pitches is like, do you want me to like send a message to somebody and tell them that your dog died? I'll do that. Like stuff like that. It's pretty funny. Pretty funny.
Yeah. He's got some.
Oh, he's undervaluing himself. He's only 34.
Does he have a commercial rate?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Let's see. Page is loading. Everybody at home just listening.
We better get a Cameo sponsor for how much we're doing on this.
We should set up our own Cameo. Just like the three of us will.
So this perfectly segues into one of the things I wanted to talk about tonight.
Okay, let's do that while Derek's looking up.
No commercial rate.
Yeah. I have to stop spreading myself so thin amongst so many things, because this week I've been so like just busy and stressed out just trying to work on this, and then I'm halfway through this one thing and then I'm like, oh, I'm actually going to pivot over here, and like, dear God, I need to focus on one thing and just move on.
What are you getting hung up on? What are the things taking up your time, right? Is it projects or is it different media outlets?
So I started designing a new router table, because I told you I wanted to do like a ShotMade router table.
Yeah.
Got like halfway through that, and then I found out I'm getting a new miter saw. So then I was like, oh, well, I should design like a miter saw station. So then I started designing that. And then I got to thinking of, what if I like 3D printed some like rails that hold like Festool sustainers so I don't have to buy them. So then I started, you know, designing these rails. And then I ran out of filament. So then I reached out to Drew Witt and was asking him about filament. And then I started researching filament. And then like, see, you see what I mean? I'm just start one thing, don't finish it. And then I have this big old pile, all of things that I need to do and get done, but I'm not getting to any of them.
I'm kind of maybe in a semi-similar position right now. I've got a bunch of things in like half-finished states.
Right.
This is why I try to just do one thing at a time. I try not to start a new project until the old one is done. It's tricky sometimes because you hit roadblocks and you're like, oh, I'm waiting for this hinge to arrive from Germany for this project.
Sure.
So you can't just bring everything to a standstill while you wait for that hinge to arrive. So you start something new.
Right.
And then you get halfway into a project and, oh, the hinge shows up. And it's like, oh, what do I do now? What do I do now? So it is hard to kind of pick the thing that's most important for you to be doing at any given moment.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's what I'm struggling with. And then on top of that, we're also planning wedding stuff. Right. So, and you know, no fault of Miranda whatsoever. She's like, hey, do you mind like looking at like hotel blocks? And I was like, absolutely. No problem. So then now I'm focusing on that too. And like, I'm getting calls about stuff like that. And then, you know, trying to figure out stuff for Christmas and like other holiday plans and like all the stuff. I'm like, I just gotta stop and just focus. And then you add the day job on top where, you know, that's crunch time to get all this stuff done. And I'm like, oh, you want to know the worst thing is I told you I hired a company to like redo my website on Shopify and stuff, right?
Sure. Yeah.
So we've been going back and forth and they've, you know, designed it and got it all set up and whatnot. And I'm like, okay. And then obviously for my own sanity, I like to still go in the background and understand, okay, you know, you put the products here, then the, you know, does this and this and, and I'm like, oh my God, they did it, but it's not clean at all. Like the back end isn't clean.
Okay. Okay. So Do you think they just didn't care? Like, are they trying to push it through super quick? Just got a little sloppy on the back end. They made the front end look real nice, but the back end's a little bit of a rush job.
Right. And I mean, full transparency, I'll just tell people I paid $2,000, which in website development is probably on the bargain side.
Yeah, I'd say so. That sounds cheap to me, but not ludicrously cheap, but on the cheaper end.
Not Fiverr cheap.
Right. Yeah. But you're probably thinking like, website's probably going to be fine. And it was more of like I wanted them to do the legwork of like bringing all of my products over so I just wasn't endlessly copying and pasting and whatnot. And then I kind of discovered, I'm like, okay, they did it, but I'm going to have to go and basically sort this out and get it situated. So the framework is there, like I understand how the Shopify platform works and whatnot, but now I'm like, okay, well now I have to do this.
Yeah.
But I really don't have to do it because my website currently still operates fine.
Yeah.
But it's something that I want to push myself to. So it's like,
is this one of those things where you can be like, hey, look, I'm happy with the design of the website, but could you clean up the back end? I'm even willing to pay like an extra $500 or something like that. That way it's off your plate, but it still gets done.
Honestly, at this point, I'm just like, I'll just do it.
Yeah.
And I know that's not necessarily the best way to approach it, but it's just like I tried to offload it to somebody. They did poorly. Yeah. And
see, this is where being like a little bit of a perfectionist and also kind of having enough skill in all these different areas kind of makes you realize when somebody, because somebody else is not doing the best job that they could. Because if you were a complete imbecile when it came to web design and I guess, more website administration,
right,
you might see their spaghetti code in the back end and be like, yeah, whatever, it works, it works.
Right.
But you've actually done it enough that you have a little bit of expertise in that space. And right. now you can see, like, oh, even I could do that better. So you're right. you've kind of screwed yourself by being too smart.
I know. And, like, I wouldn't even consider myself great at it. But, like, you know, I understand, like, the collections and sub-menus and sub-collections and all that kind of stuff. They put all of my products just as in one thing.
Right.
And I was like, but if somebody, like, wants to, like, sort. Like, you know, you go to Old Navy and you look for a pair of jeans, right? You're like,
yeah.
All right, I want to sort it high to low. Nope. Yeah.
Interesting.
Like, it was just, oh, so I'm frustrated by that. But I've cleaned up a lot of it. I've pretty much fired them today. I was like, I'll take it from here. Thanks for your time. I'm going to unlink you guys as like an admin on the account. We're done. They're like, can we set up a call? No.
Okay. Did you give them a chance to fix it? Did you express your unhappiness? Or
I did.
So,
and they're like, well, you know, the website functions fine. We found that that's the most optimal way to set it up. And I'm like, oh, fuck off. Oh, for you. There it is. Explicit.
Oh, there we go. Now we're all free to swear from now on. Yay. Right. Those fuckers.
Yeah. I mean, and I think you're totally right. And this is my airing of grievances. Yeah, I think you're totally right. I got what I paid for. And truly, if I wanted a good website that was really set up well, I probably should have expected to pay $5,000 to $10,000, right?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it, yeah. Like that dude's in the comments right now, he's a web developer, and he was saying, you know, kind of 5K Canadian to 3 to 5K Canadian is his kind of range.
Okay.
And
yeah.
I don't even know if that includes a store or not. So,
right. Right.
Yeah. So, you live and you learn, right?
Yeah.
And look, you got, at the very least, you have a website you have a nice design for a website, right?
Right.
You like the design of it. So at least that's something. You're coming out of it. Maybe the back end's not as tidy as it could be. And maybe you could hire somebody else to fix it for you. But at this point, maybe it just makes sense to do it yourself because you are a little bit of an expert in that space.
Yeah. And honestly, like I've got most of the back end stuff situated now. Now it's just kind of like front end design, which isn't terrible. It's really not too bad to do. So I think I'll be all right.
Good.
It's just I'm the reason I'm bummed about that is because I was excited. I'm like, okay, I want to link that to YouTube and Instagram and then like start getting my plans on there. And then I want to start being able to sell 3D printed files. And I'm like, Eric, slow down.
Yeah.
Just get one thing working really well and then move on.
Yes. It's a good lesson for people to learn starting, you know, a content business or any business. Do one thing well. Mm-hmm. You just get so overwhelmed trying to spread yourself so thin between all of these different tasks.
Right. I mean, it could be the same thing if you're building custom furniture. Like, oh, I want to start banking chairs, but then I want to make coffee tables. But then I also think I want to do cutting boards. Just focus on one.
Yeah, there was a good book about entrepreneurism that I read. I think it's called Zero to One. I think
that sounds familiar. Yeah. Who's it by?
Yeah, Blake Masters and Peter Thiel.
That does sound familiar.
And I think this is the book that I read where I learned this lesson, but they talk about MVP or minimum viable product. And the whole idea is like, just do one thing, like focus down on doing one thing that you know you can accomplish. And then build up from there. And then I think that in the similar spirit, it's like do one thing well before you start trying to diversify into other things. So
it's a
good lesson for anybody who wants to start a business in any field.
I think that mindset that you constantly hear now of the just pedal to the metal, just go, 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 grind. Like, I disagree with it.
It's accurate in some ways, I guess. Like, you know, I'm still a believer that hard work pays off.
Oh, for sure.
Once you find something, you know, that you're good at, you can work away at, and you can build a, you know, you can build a business for yourself. But I think it's also leaving out the part where you got to get good at doing something before you start, you know, grinding all the time in a million different directions. It's better to be focused like a laser beam.
Yeah. I think But it's my own. It's my own doing. It's my own doing. Uh oh, did we lose Zach?
We lost his audio.
And we are back. Sorry, everybody, for the technical difficulties. The battery on my microphone pack died.
Well, we're back, baby. We are back.
This is the downside to using the same microphone for the podcast that you also use for video recording. Because I ran down the batteries recording something, and I guess I forgot to charge it, and then just threw on my camera to go tonight. Oopsies.
It happens. Well, anyway, enough about me complaining about what I've been attempting to work on. What have you been working on, Zach? You said you're stressed out. You're working on all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. Well, okay. So I spent last week, I think on the podcast, I talked about electroplating, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
This is something that I really want to try. So I'm gearing up to electroplate some 3D prints.
Did you do it yet?
So I went over to my friend's workshop. He got a job to electroplate this set of old antique knives. So I was like, you know what? And a completely unrelated, just crazy coincidence that he got this job at the exact same time that I got interested in electroplating. Right. So he gets all the equipment over in his workshop. He gets the antique knives. I go over. I spend a couple days doing it with him, trying to learn the ins and outs of it. I figured I can practice on his stuff, and then when it comes time to do mine, I'll actually have a little bit of experience under my belt.
Yeah.
And it's an interesting process, man. So basically, you get a big jug of distilled water, or a big bucket filled with distilled water. You put copper crystals into it. You put battery acid into it. Then you put your part wrapped in a conductive wire into the middle of the tank. You put two electrodes on the, you know, kind of at the, you know, 12 o'clock and 6 o'clock position.
Sure.
And then you run a current through the electrodes into your part, and then back to the power supply, and it slowly causes the copper to condense on whatever item it is you have in there. Yeah, so it was and it's fantastic. Like, it's crazy quick. Like, we dipped parts in and you could pull them out 30 seconds later and they would have a thin layer of copper on them already.
And is it pretty like stout? Like, once it's on there, is like it's not coming off, or is it like, oh, is it like gold? Yes. Flaking?
Yeah, so we got kind of screwed up because as it turns out, there's probably three or four different ways to electroplate something, and we were told that the antique knives we were working on were made out of nickel, but they had been water damaged. That was part of the reason that he got the job to restore them. So they were also kind of corroded, and the nickel was flaking away in some areas. So on the nickel, it stuck like crazy. But on the other areas of the knife where it was kind of corroded, there was some pitting. The electroplating wouldn't stick. So it was actually a frustrating day for us. But if I were to take a 3D printed part that I had properly prepped, that electroplating would be on there. Like, as well as, you know, any paint bonds to any material.
Yeah.
So it's definitely viable, and it's got me really excited to do the full thing.
Does it have anything to do with like how like porous like the material is?
No. So I don't even. So you don't want anything porous. You want to polish it to basically a shine before you go in. Yeah. So you want to have it. It's a like a chemical process, I guess, maybe on some level, because there is battery acid in there. Maybe it is very finely etching the surface to get better adhesion. I don't really know. It's kind of magical, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, it's super interesting.
Yeah, so I'm very excited to try it, because basically at the end of the day, what you can get out of it is you can 3D print parts and then have them look and to a certain degree even feel like they're made out of metal.
And so this is the one you want to do the PS2 case for, right?
The Dreamcast case.
Dreamcast.
Yeah. So it's actually interesting. So copper is kind of the base, and that's the easiest thing to get to stick to a bunch of different surfaces. And then from copper, you can then plate on more metals. So if you wanted to do gold, you could do that. If you wanted to do silver, you could do that. If you wanted to do nickel. So there's all these things that you can add on top of copper as well.
Oh, man. See, now this gives me an idea. Do you have the ability to, like, basically 3D print, and I'm using air quotes, premium objects and, like, it, like, plate them and be like, oh, this is a 3D printed, I don't know, I'm making this up, a bracelet. And now this bracelet I can charge you $700 for. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. Yeah. I think so. I guess setting the price point's kind of up to you, but you could definitely make a gold ring that was 3D printed.
And it would look like a metal, like something you'd find at a jewelry store.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
It would cost $0.20 to make.
The example I saw was somebody printed the Lord of the Rings ring.
Sure, sure. Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, and then they plated it in gold, and it looked awesome.
But it seems like the setup isn't conducive for one-off items.
It's going to be a lot of work for just one video game console case, but it's, you know, I wouldn't do it if I were in some sort of production environment, but for a YouTube video, I think it's
I mean, you're doing it for the video. Like, so yeah. let's hypothetically say you 3D printed 1,000 rings and you wanted to plate them all. Would there be a way that you could, like, batch it and, like,
For sure. You could do like 50 at once.
Okay.
You could just thread a copper rod through them.
If it fits into that and they don't touch, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
No, if they did touch, would they potentially fuse together?
Yeah, that's kind of the risk you run. If they might potentially fuse together.
And you have no risk of it fusing to the wire itself.
Not in the limited bit that I did. I think it's interesting. You can vary the amperage and the voltage of, or sorry, Scott Walsh would kill me, the current and the voltage that you're sending through it. And that will affect the speed that the copper plate builds up on the surface of the thing that you want to, that you're plating. And if you go too fast, you can end up with these nodules and stuff. So there's always a trade-off between artifacts on the plating and the speed at which you do it. So the faster you're plating, the more the faster you plate, the more likely you are to end up being fused to the wire or to another nearby object or something.
That makes sense. It's just like 3D printing, you know, the faster speed you print at, there's a trade-off of quality the faster you go, right?
Yes, definitely.
Makes sense. That's interesting though.
Yeah, I'm pretty pumped to try it. I just ordered all the chemicals and stuff that I need. It was about $500. It was kind of annoying, but
what are you gonna do with all this, with this whole setup once you're done?
I don't know. You do it in like a 5-gallon bucket, so I'll probably just put a lid on it and put it into storage for a little bit. But
does that stuff have like a half life though?
I don't know. That's a good question. Not to my knowledge so far, no, it doesn't. But we'll see. Maybe I'll crack it open to use it in 6 months, and I'll be like, damn, I had to buy new copper crystals or whatever.
Yeah, there'll be a goblin or something that grew in it. It'd be a Demogorgon.
Yeah.
Or a Green Suitors podcast fan. Mm-hmm. Available on Apple and Spotify. Well, speaking of people who hate the Green Suitors podcast, our top-tier patrons are back this week. We want to give a huge shout-out to Chris from Black Forest Creations, Josh at Freedom Workshop, Dadu, and of course, Corey Duvall.
Yep.
And if you want to support the show, get access to the after show, get your crack at winning that $50 gift card every single month, just go to patreon.com/offthecutpodcast. And
that's right.
I was actually chatting with one of our patrons today, Gary Furness. Mm-hmm. He said that he's been
top tier, right?
Well, so he was. He was telling me that there was some Patreon issue where he got kicked off of several Patreon things, and he couldn't figure it out. I've not been kicked off any of the Patreon things that I support. I've not had any issues with it, but it seems like a lot of people are having issues. So again, throwing this out there. If anybody is like, hey, I used to get the after show, it's not popping up anymore, just, you know, check on Patreon, see what's going on, maybe update your billing. But if you want to cancel, no harm. You know, just want to throw that out there. Throwing it out there. Well,
Patreon, such a messy program or platform.
Oh, it's a nightmare. But it's, I mean, honestly, it's the best for this and putting out the after show, because we have fun doing that. Mm-hmm. But let's see what else we got going on.
Well, what are you working on?
So, still working on the website. I'm working, working on the miter saw station. I'm working on the router table. I'm working on all that kind of stuff. But I want to ask your guys' feedback.
Oh, okay.
Would you rather talk about the router table or the miter saw station?
Let me hear the miter saw station. I want to. Yeah, can you say which new saw you just got?
Yeah, it's the cordless Festool Cape Perks.
Oh, okay. So you're going to run a cordless saw in your shop.
That's why I was so excited about it, because I don't have to run power to it. I just keep batteries in it, and I'm just ready to rock.
True.
You don't use it all the time, so.
Right.
Yeah. My experience is that the cordless saws are a little bit slower to speed up.
Yeah.
To get up to their... I've never used the Festool one, though, so maybe they got it figured out. Is it 10-inch blade or 12-inch?
10-inch, yeah.
10-inch, so it's a little bit smaller. Well, I don't know what your old one was.
So no competition mitering for you.
Yeah.
Oh, what? Oh.
Yeah, you're not going to be able to do any... Yeah, you can't do
anything. Oh, yeah, speed running.
But you hate miter saws, too. I forgot that little
detail. I do.
Yeah.
I do hate miter saws, and that's why I'm interested to see if I can get this in there and if I enjoy it. But the question becomes, do I go through the whole rigmarole of making like a miter saw station when I'm not going to be in this garage for a year from now? I won't be in the garage.
Interesting. Well, you can always make one that you can take with you, or you can use for something else, right? Let's be honest. A miter saw station is just a bench that's got a little cutout for a miter saw in it, right?
Yeah.
So worst case scenario, you build a little insert later to fill in where the miter saw used to go and just use it as a regular workbench.
Or it becomes yet another video. Here's what I learned from my first miter saw station.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, or you bring it to your new place and then you add more wings onto it to extend it out further.
Yeah. So what do you need? What makes a good miter saw station? Like,
ooh, good question.
You know what? I think that's your video. You do the first miter saw station, but you do it as like a beginner intro, like plywood style miter saw station. Yeah, just like a basic one that is obtainable to virtually anybody that's in their home shop. And then for your next one, whenever you get the home, that's whenever you redo it, but you do it as like a, you know, the bigger,
Here's what I learned that I needed. Like, I'm not building out the ultimate miter saw station because I've never had one.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of bare bones in it and then seeing like, ugh, this drives me nuts. Ooh, I wish I had this. Ooh.
Yeah.
It's not a bad idea.
You get two miter saw builds out of it.
And two plans.
Yeah. And two sets of plans. I would say you need some sort of stop block system.
Okay.
Key track with a stop block on it.
Cam tool stop block available at camtools.com.
Do you get it with your logo on it like everybody else has been getting?
You need a little basket to hold a pencil, a set of safety glasses, and a tape measure. What else do you need? You need a little cup holder. You need a little cutout so you can run a dust collection hose up to the back of it.
Ooh, yeah.
But
that already raises problems, because I have my shop vac underneath my workbench.
Yes.
So would I move it to underneath the miter saw, and then whenever I need to, or do I have to buy another shop vac?
No. What you do is you build an extension hose into the workbench. And then you have like a nice convenient place where you just plug in Just jam it in there. You have the Festool dust extractor, right?
Yes. Yes.
Does it have Bluetooth or something built into it and it talks to the saw?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you don't have to worry about actually like turning it on every time. So you just need to plug in the hose somewhere. So make like a hard pipe that goes from the desk collection of the miter saw down to the bottom of the saw, somewhere that's nice and easily accessible, and then you just plug the Festool thing in there.
It's not a bad, because like, yeah, that's not a bad idea. Because like Derek said, I mean, I'm really not going to use the miter saw that often.
Yeah.
Or yeah, during I don't the have times my... I use it, do I just run the hose across, you know, a 3-foot gap, and then just, you know, it's going to look like hell, but.
That's basically what I do every time I use my miter saw, and I want to hook up the dust collection to it.
All right.
What else do you need in a miter saw station?
Does it come on like the portable stand, or is it just the miter saw itself?
I don't know if they're sending that to me. If it comes on the portable stand, I'm just keeping it on the portable stand probably.
Yeah. Is it one of those ones that you can like break down
and
like into dolly almost?
Right.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
Huh. So, talk to me about the saw. Is it on bars? Like, is it just a Capex but cordless?
Right.
Okay.
So it's on the bars and stuff. It takes two batteries. I've used it at the demo units. It seems like it works super, super well. So I'm excited. Test it out. Put it in the show.
For like a half second at the show that they did here in Toronto. It looks good. It looks like an interesting little saw. So they're sending it to you?
Yeah, we're doing some sort of campaign in either December or January for it. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Neat. I don't know what'll come with it, but we'll see. We shall see. I don't know. Let me ask you this.
Okay.
I know I want to have some sort of place to be able to put like, you know, like the little sustainer bins where you have your screws and stuff like that. Cause I like those. They organize them. It's the same as like the Milwaukee, like pack out boxes where they have the screw bins and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Is that too much for the quote beginner miter saw station?
Well, what's going to go in this, in the sustainers? Is it going to be stuff related to the miter saw? Because you're talking about screws and stuff like that, right?
I just need a place to put like the screw bins and whatnot.
Yeah.
It's more just general storage. Or do I just do like open shelving for this one? For somebody who's not trying to get into learning how to make doors and drawers, they just want like a...
Yeah. I would say for the beginner one, don't do any sort of integrated Festool storage system, because no beginner is going to have
alienates everyone out of that.
Yeah, exactly. You're catering to somebody, like, let's face it, most beginners have a hodgepodge of tools from different brands. It's kind of just stuff they've accumulated over the years, right?
So maybe just like doors where you just kind of open up a door and it has like open shelves.
I think so. I think that's probably the best. And also because from your point of view, you're selling plans. If your plans are tailored to Festool products, anybody who doesn't have a Festool is immediately like, why would I buy these plans? They don't apply
true
to me.
And go ahead, Derek, sir.
I was going to say, presumably you've got 3 cavities under your miter saw station, right?
Sure.
So you're going to do 3 doors, right?
Yeah,
you could do 2 doors and drawers underneath of it, and then in your plans have the option to either do doors or drawers, and then make all the drawers one size, make all the cabinets the same size except for the height being different in the middle one there, and so it's kind of modular in that way that then the user could pick which one that they wanted to do. If they just want to go the basic route and do doors, they could do doors on all 3 of them. But if they want drawers, then they'd have the option to go ahead and add drawers.
Mm,
and then
not
you
a bad
would
idea.
Do it with both.
And then what about this? What about if you had some sort of 3D printed file or some other secondary file that would allow people to upgrade to sustainer storage?
Yeah, there
what
you
what if
go.
You what if you had like the, you know, the sustainer? Oh, he's reaching for something. Is he already working on this? Yeah, there you go. Exactly.
These little guys here, they're the same thing that Festool sells, but it's a smaller kind of 3D printed home version. So you jam your sustainer in the front and it kind of like locks itself into this little rail.
Yeah.
And I can print these out for like $1.
Yeah.
A piece.
So what and, you do is you just have a general, you have a drawer cabinet.
Yeah.
Or like but a cabinet happens to be the right width. Happens to be the right width. And you say, by the way, if you want to pay $3 or whatever, $5 for my 3D print files, you can throw your sustainers in there.
See, and now this is where I start. This is, and that's, see, I had this exact same idea. And I'm glad you guys thought the same thing. But then I start thinking, well, do I want to sell the 3D print file? Or are the majority of people just going to say, just send me the damn part? I want to buy the part from you. The problem is Festool sells these for $10 for a pair.
Right.
If I were to print that, I'm never going to beat that price.
Yeah, you're like $2 in plastic, say, or maybe $1 in plastic, something like that.
Right.
And then your time to put it in a box, take it to the post office, and ship it out.
And then they'd have to pay shipping, whereas Festool stuff is always free shipping.
Is it? Do they do free shipping even on their little $10 part?
I think so. Well, you have to get them in like an 8-pack or something like that.
Gotcha.
So it ends up being like $80 or whatever.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to beat Festool there. And also, just saying, you know, you're working, you're partnering with Festool. They might frown on you selling a product that technically takes away sales from them.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know.
But selling the 3D print files, like a little bit more of a gray area. Honestly, I think you sell that 3D print file for like $5. And I mean, not that many people have 3D printers. I guess that's the downside, right?
Right, right.
Yeah.
And see, that's, and then that perfectly draws back into the, that's why I want to get this website set up so I have the ability to do all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, definitely.
Sell the files and the prints and whatnot. But yeah, I don't know. There's so much going into the miter saw station where like, I know that if it were me, I want to have like a laminate top on it.
Okay.
And, but I also think laminate is very challenging for that beginner builder. Like, oh, I don't want to do with this. So I just, do I just get black melamine and move on?
Yeah. I mean, I would, how do you package this as a video? It's an interesting question. Cause if I were going to do my own miter saw station, well, I did, and I have laminate countertops on it, right? Because I wanted it to be smooth sliding. It's almost like you want to say, but like you want to do the video and you want to be like, if you don't want to go to all the effort of doing this, then just buy black melamine at Home Depot.
True.
And slap it on there.
So is the black melamine just going on plywood? I'm assuming.
You mean black, the laminate would go on
the laminate. Yeah.
Yeah. It would just go on plywood.
Yeah.
So you build it up as plywood and then you say at this point, you know, you can stop and you have plywood and you're good to go. But if you want to take it up another notch, you get this, melamine or whatever or laminate. And then you got a nice smooth surface.
Yeah, I guess, see,
like an upgrade.
My biggest struggle with it is how much time do I sink into this knowing that it is only going to be a short live thing, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I often think about these types of projects, and the math always comes down to how much time is this project going to save me over the course of my woodworking career? You know, a properly laid out miter saw station might save you some time here and there. But right. Then also, you have to balance that against the amount of time that it's going to take you to build the thing.
Right.
Yeah.
And then if you also make it into a video, well, you've just doubled or tripled how long it's going to take to do
it. I know.
So, yeah. And do you think that's...
And then how much are you going to use it?
I know.
Yeah. And then will that video perform well? Because there's a lot of videos out there about miter saw stations.
That's why it almost seems like to have a miter saw station video that actually does something, it needs to have that like wow factor to it, right?
Like sliding left and right.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Like look at Scott Walsh's last video. He made it, you know, he put it on glide tracks and everything. So
Did it perform well?
I think I think if you talk to him, he might not be super happy about the results. I think he's like mid-100,000s.
I'd be happy with that.
Yeah.
If I hit 100, I'm pumped.
Yeah, 113,000 in 3 weeks.
It's not bad.
Yeah, it's not bad at all. So yeah. So there is definitely, there's an audience for miter saw stations out there. I know I've seen this miter saw station in real life. I think he's probably invested a metric boatload of time into this. So I don't know how happy he is with 113,000 views.
Right.
Because that's like a 100 to 200 hour workbench right there.
I almost might frame it as like, I've never had a miter saw station before, which is true. Mm-hmm. I don't know what I want out of it. Like, invite people to just leave tons of comments. Oh, you should add this, should have added this, should have added this. And I think people are going to, people might like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Make the basic one and then ask for feedback, participation, and then you use it on the next one if you decide to do it better next time.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. You need a bit of a hook though. Like, what's the hook?
Right.
Can you say like beginner workbench, I want feedback in the title and have people actually click on it? I don't know.
I'm going to say the title is going to be, I finally admit it, I was wrong. And so it's going to be like the whole time I'm talking is like, you know, I've been saying you don't need a miter saw. Like, it's not going to work out for me. And I decided it's finally time to see if I'm right or wrong. I'm building a simple miter saw station to kind of test it out, test the water, see what features I like, see what I don't like, and see if it's actually something that I stand by saying they still suck or if I'm wrong.
Do you think that's actually a good title for... So I had a video that I titled that a long time ago.
Sure.
And it performed horribly. And it was a different thing. It was on a crappy video, so the performance might have been more related to the contents of the video than the actual title. But consider it from an outsider's perspective. If somebody's never seen your channel before and that pops up in their feed, and it's, you know, the title's just admitting I was wrong, they're like, well, I don't know who Eric Spensley is, so I don't really care.
Valid.
I don't, you know what I mean? You need to have something that's like, somebody's never heard about
this tool.
Somebody's never seen a Spensley Design Co. video before. Why are they clicking on that?
Yeah. Something that maybe. So, okay. Maybe you go along lines of like, I refuse to use this tool, but was I wrong.
I wrote off this tool.
I said I would never use this tool.
Yeah. Yeah. That's definitely, I think, moving in a better direction.
Or I would never use the most popular woodworking tool.
Ooh, yeah, there's definitely something there.
Yeah.
That's intriguing.
Yeah, yeah.
But do you like the overall sentiment of the video? Kind of like talking about the fact that, like, you know, I'm going to, over the next several months, going to see if it's actually something I like. And then if I do, I'm going to invest in the ultimate miter saw station.
There you go.
It's interesting because I've kind of stopped. Remember when we were listening to Cam from Blacktail talk at Workbench Conference, and he said he stopped saying anything self-deprecating in videos.
Mm.
So I've kind of moved away from talking. I think we both have a tendency to do this. We both kind of play up the fact that, you know, we're not experts.
Mm. I see what you're saying.
And I think that's a good thing to feel and to have internally, but I'm not sure it necessarily performs that well in videos.
Mm.
Humility works if you don't broadcast it.
Yeah, like you can't wear it too much on your sleeve, because then the audience is like, well, why would I listen to this guy, or why would I?
Yeah. Valid.
That is.
I wanted to show you how to make a very bare bones, like, miter saw station. Like, anyone can do it.
I think that is a better angle to approach. Like, I'm going to show you, like, yeah, this is the ideal beginner miter saw station.
You know,
so what? Sorry, go ahead.
No, you go.
I was going to say, I would almost maybe even not, I don't think I would play up so much the fact that it's your first miter saw station. You've never used a miter saw before. Like, that might be a fun detail to have in there, But I would still like, I don't know, like
5 years into my woodworking journey and I finally made a miter cut.
Yeah.
It's interesting you bring that up, Zach, because the one video that I did that I didn't think was going to do anything last year was I did it with Craig. It was a single sheet of plywood workbench. And the whole thing in that is I started out basically, I think the title was The Biggest Lie on YouTube.
Yeah.
And the whole, like, I started out with, like, you watch all these YouTube videos on, you know, making workbenches, and they require just boatloads of tools and shop space and stuff. I'm going to, you know, but that's the biggest lie. I'm going to show you how to make this workbench with literally just a drill and a circular saw.
Yeah.
So, like, but almost kind of hit it by that. And that video's done great. Several hundred thousand.
See, I think that's a stronger hook for video because that appeals to the audience. You know, you're creating this entry level workbench that anybody can make. Yeah. Like that appeals to a wide audience of people. Whereas the video, I've never made a workbench before, so I'm going to make a crappy one. And then in 5 months or 5 years, I'm going to make a better one. It's kind of like, well, I'll skip this video and I'll just watch the one in 5 years when he makes the really good one.
No, I'm genuinely, thank you for your feedback. I didn't think about that. And it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like the miter saw station isn't necessarily a beginner project either.
True. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. Like mobile miter saw stations, like a flip up wing one, like those go bananas.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I don't know. Maybe once I get the saw, I'll like kind of, you know, set it in the garage, kind of, you know, see how things work, see how things feel, and then see what speaks to me.
Yeah. Yeah. I would think on it a little bit, definitely get the saw and like see how it feels in the space. Cause like you were saying, like it might even be, I mean, maybe a better video would be like, should you build a miter saw station or should you just use the little stand that it came with?
Oh,
or, you know, I don't know, like the, John Malecki always does those, you know, DIY amateur pro. So you could have like the three levels of miter saw stations or something that.
Do you know how long that would take?
I know that's a big ask. Like that's a big video.
Can I build it better than a 100-year-old tool brand can or something like that?
Yeah. Is a one sheet plywood miter saw station better than the stand that it just comes with?
There you go.
Like I build a miter saw stand out of one sheet of plywood or something like that.
Or maybe, you know, like the Festool stand costs, let's say $250 for the sake of argument.
Okay.
Can you build a better stand for $250 or should you just buy it?
Because the Festool stand is nice. It doesn't have storage, but like it's got stop blocks. It's got like the wings. It folds up. So I'm going to look this up. Okay.
Buy it or build it? ?
No, I like that. That's not bad. Okay, sawing. Capex cordless. There's an error loading the page. Come on, Festool.
Don't you know we're trying to do a podcast here, Festool?
The underframe. Okay, it's called the underframe. I can't load it. Okay. Festool Capex underframe. It is $1,000.
Oh my god! Well, okay, you can definitely build something.
Okay,
but maybe like factor in your time or something. Like, you know, give yourself an hourly rate.
Yeah. So the stand is $630, okay. And then the wings are $695. But if you get it together, it's $1,000. Okay. Well, there goes the idea of like, can I build it cheaper?
Well, no, but say like maybe give yourself like an hourly wage of $50 or something like that.
I should do $150 and the people get so mad.
My time is worth $1,000 an hour. So let's see if I can build this thing in 30 minutes.
All right. Ooh, that's not a bad idea. These are ideas to ponder.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Derek, I think they're coming for you.
The police outside.
I think they finally figured you out, man.
You know what they're probably here for, right? The after show.
There we go.
Wait. Oh, yeah. Okay. I wasn't gone for that long when I had the technical difficulties, was I?
No, you were like 45 2 minutes max.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. I guess that's after show time then, baby.
Well, we're heading over to the after show because we got a deep dish pizza we got to throw in the oven. And we got some questions to answer. And yeah, we're heading over there. Everybody, thanks so much for listening. I know we have a bunch of new listeners because I did a giveaway in my most recent YouTube video. And it's through that Gleam service. And like you like get like sign up thingies when you click on stuff. Our listenership is going up again. Yeah. So welcome all the new listeners. Okay.
Well, thank you for that. Now I got to do a giveaway on my channel where I also use the Gleam thing.
You got to use the Gleam thing, man.
Okay. Get us some new subscribers.
Yeah. So everybody, thanks for checking out the show. We appreciate the support. If you want to support the show and get access to the after show and live chats with us and video calls, Discord, all kinds of stuff like that. Oh, and the Cam Tools gift card every month. Oh,
yeah.
Go to patreon.com/offthecuffpodcast.
For a $3 a month investment, you might end up like Chris, where you win over $300 worth of stuff.
And if I'm not mistaken, that now puts us at what, close to about 10, or is it $11 million in giveaways? We're pretty, we're getting
11.6.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, carry the three. Yeah, yeah, Derek's right, 11.6.
We're up there. We're up there. We're like Oprah, basically.
You get a router plane, and you get a router plane.
Everyone gets one. All right, well, enough blabbering, everybody. We'll catch you next week, or we'll catch you over at the after show.
See ya.